You are a flowing stream. You are the fountain of abundance washing over me. You are a mighty river. You are a flowing stream. You are the fountain of abundance washing over me. Be still and know I am. Be still.
There's got to be more than going back and forth, from doing right to doing wrong, 'cause we were taught that's who we are. Well, come on, get in line right behind me, you along with everybody, thinking there's worth in what you do. Then like a hero who takes the stage, when we're on the edge of our seat, saying it's too late, let me introduce you to Amazing Grace. Take a filthy wretch like this and wrap him up in righteousness. But that's exactly what he did. No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, still the truth is a cross has made. The cross has made you flawless.
But there was no one that I could tell. Praying felt like I was throwing pennies in a wishing well. And I started believing I was cursed to carry this weight. I was listing the reasons of why I should walk away. Until grace called my name. Until grace found me. Until grace broke these chains. Oh, I didn't know I could be free. Until grace found, your grace found me. I might be looking at a future full of question marks, but I don't have to have all of the answers if you have my heart. In you, I'm finding redemption a little more with every breath. Brand new like the morning, and I'll never forget. Until grace found me. Oh, found me. Until grace. Woo. Broke these chains. Oh, I didn't know I could be free. Until grace found your grace. Found me. Oh,
out of agreement with the lie that you have left me on my own. Oh, I am not alone. I come out of agreement with the worry and the fear I've come to know. No, they won't have a hold on me. Torment me, no weapon, no worry will prosper against me. No darkness, no evil will tease or torment me. Oh, power, dominion, to what name is given? My fortress, my freedom, my refuge, my Jesus. Oh, power, dominion.
Hello, Cheyenne Hills. Welcome to the pre-show. My name is Julie Fogg, and I'm your host. And back with me today is Pastor Galen. So good to have you back in studio.
Good to be back.
It's been such a fun series, and I know that you were super excited about teaching through Dr. Seuss.
Yeah.
But it's been a lot of fun, and I think the biblical applications have been really deep.
They've been amazing. You know, I thought, you know, Dick Berry did a great job last week of with the Sneetches, mm-hmm. and I just think it's been an amazing, it's real sticky. We talk about things that are sticky that will stick with you. And, mm-hmm. and my biggest fear is that through my whole career, they're going to say, do you remember that series that we did on the, Dr. Seuss? And it's like, That's the only thing I got to remember because this is so sticky.
It is.
It really is sticky. And this is the one that I have to admit that I kind of drug my heels on the whole time. It's like, you guys, I'm not sure if I'm crazy about this whole direction. And the creative people were just, you know, saying, oh, that could be great. And it's been great.
Yeah. Well, and it is kind of risky to jump in and not really know that how people are going to perceive it. And Dr. Seuss can be controversial. And so not knowing how all those things will land, but really when you can sort through and, you know, I just keep coming back to fables that we've grown up with and the teachable lessons in there are so important. And so to be able to look at children's literature and see like there's really a deeper level. And so it's been really good.
It really helps you understand why Jesus used parables. I mean, he really spoke to their world when he attached biblical truth to a farming illustration, you know, or you know, that grain dies and then it'll, you know, it raises something completely different. And that whole idea of a farming illustration, well, that's kind of what when you hit things that are familiar from your childhood and you make an application to it, you attach it to that, it goes deep.
And, you know, when you guys came back from Israel, there were several different stories that you told of things that you had seen and experienced that really made those parables so much more understandable in our Western lens, we don't necessarily understand what Jesus meant by those. But that's a really good application of how that he taught and that we can really learn as well.
Just drives it to your soul so you can remember it. It's sticky.
It is sticky.
Thank you for joining us today. Cheyenne Hills Church is located in Cheyenne, Wyoming, the heart of the West. We have ministry partners all over the world, across the street in Utah, Colorado, and Wyoming, and around the world in Uganda, India, and Israel. If you would like to join us in reaching out to make a difference in our world, you can donate through CheyenneHills.org or the CHC app. Simply click Give to be automatically redirected to our secure giving site where you can create your personal account. It's that easy. You can also experience our services, events, podcasts, and more on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, or on our Cheyenne Hills app. For now, let's get back to today's service.
Across the street and around the world, Cheyenne Hills.
All right, well, Galen, Dick Berry did great last week with the trivia questions. He was 3 for 3.
No kidding.
Yeah. So he did real well. You're 5 for 6.
5 for 6.
So we'll see how you're going to do today. Unfortunately, so Green Eggs and Ham is the book that you're teaching from this week. I don't have any props. If I really was on my game, I would have had some Green Eggs and Ham. And I searched through our questions for Green Eggs and Ham questions. There were not.
None.
So, so we're going to dig into some different ones. So first question, in one fish, two fish, red fish, blue fish, what does Ish wish will appear on his dish? A, hen's Cornish, B, a big nish, or C, a fish?
I'm going to go with B.
No, it was C, a fish.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
That's okay.
I'm going to try to logically work. Okay.
Okay. All right. Question number two is a rhyme. It says, on his hook, he had a book. On his book was, quote, take a look, B, how to cook, C, don't get shook.
Oh, gosh.
I know. I didn't mean to pick hard ones, but they kind of are.
I'm B.
Yay. Good job, Galen. How to cook.
Okay.
All right, and here is question number three. This is actually, I think, out of the Sneetches. So it says, those stars weren't so big. They were really so small. You might think such a thing wouldn't matter, A, to Paul, B, in fall, or C, at all.
At all.
A, yeah, good job.
Yeah, that was a good one. I can get that
one. 2 out of 3, so good job. You're 7 out of 9 total.
Oh, man.
Proud of you, Galen.
That's
good
awesome.
Job. Those were some harder wins. But anyway.
Got my reading done for the week.
You did. And so, and speaking of, we're attacking green eggs and ham. So tell us a little, so I have to just tell you a little bit of interesting information about Dr. Seuss.
Okay.
So I read this little biography. It's actually a kid's biography about him. But the reason that he wrote Cat in the Hat, Green Eggs and Ham, One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish, was that there was a need for some interesting children's books that had high frequency words. So there's a list of words that appear very often in literature.
Okay.
So anything you read, so, you know, and
Gotcha.
And so, you know, and there's a lot of repetition, which helps to learn those rhyming words, those sounds, right. and all that kind of thing. So right. Green Eggs and Ham is one of those that came from that. And so he there really had a high value for children's literacy. Well, so kind of cool.
There are some rants there. When he says, I will not have them in here or there. I will. And so he goes through all of those things again several times. So there is a lot of repetition in this book. So, you can read it pretty quickly. It's if you're at home, you can get through this. But no, the way that we're going to use it, I'm going to use it today, is this guy or this thing comes along and tries to, I am Sam. Sam comes along, and he tries to convince this guy to try green eggs and ham. Mm-hmm. Why did he try them? Here, there, anywhere, in a boat, with a goat, all these things. Mm-hmm. And he won't do it. And finally he tries them, and, well, you're going to have to find out if he likes them or not. But it's the idea of, blessed are the feet that bring good news. You know, bringing the good news of the gospel, sometimes we need to be persistent. Hmm. And sometimes we need to present it in all kinds of different ways. So that's the angle I'm going to take with Green Eggs and Ham today with from Dr. Seuss.
Very cool. And, you know, it's really neat because this is a baptism weekend, so it fits really appropriately.
So I may have to ask here or there, would you accept Christ anywhere? You know, who knows what?
That's fantastic.
On a boat. I may have to come up with some more rhymes there.
Yeah, well, definitely work on that.
Well, yeah, Dick Berry, you know, he set the bar pretty high.
He did.
He can talk Seuss. I'm not sure if I'm there yet.
Yeah, he can maybe help you out a little bit and coach you on some of that. Well, you know, it's just really neat. And really to think of this as an evangelism type of structure that really he was persistent. We want to do that as well. And so
just try him. Try taste and see that the Lord is good. That'll be another theme that'll come through today.
Absolutely. Well, thanks so much for that. We look forward to hearing your message, and we look forward to connecting with you. You can send us any prayer requests or any questions you might have at connect@cheyennehills.org. And we look forward to seeing you after service, and we will talk more with Pastor Galen about Green Eggs and Ham. Until then, enjoy our service.
Church, we're in this elevation, and I am so excited to be here worshiping with you. That you may be seated. That's an awesome song. Welcome. Glad you're here today. If you're following us online, welcome. So glad you're here. And, you know, just that continual connection of people being out there, it's kind of exciting to know that you're there. So thanks for the feedback and all that. If you are here for the very first time, we have a gift for you as you leave. Guest services out there, and they've got a gift for you, so hope you stop by that. Announcement-wise, we are concluding Saturday nights. Our last Saturday night service will be next week, and so I just want to make sure you know that. We are planning on replacing that with a service across the parking lot in the barn. We're going to do something early Sunday morning. We'll probably start that early 2022. So hopefully that will be a replacement for that, and utilize our volunteers maybe better. So that's what we're hoping. So hopefully that will work for people. The finally thing is today I'm going to talk to you about persistence. In fact, I'm going to be persistent on just bugging the heck out of you. Anybody had somebody bug the heck out of them before? And you finally said, okay, finally, I'll go. I'll do it. Okay, well, that's kind of what I'm going to do today, so just brace yourself. But before we get to the sermon, I want to bug the heck out of you. If you are a volunteer at Shine Hills Church or have been a volunteer at Shine Hills Church, I really want you to come tomorrow night, 6 o'clock, here at the church, because we're going to have a volunteer appreciation. We've never done anything quite like this before. And I don't care if you're volunteering on this end of the building, the children's end, I don't care. Volunteer is volunteer. And we'd like for you to come. We're going to start in the barn. We're going to have some hors d'oeuvres and those kinds of things. And then we're going to come across here. And then we're going to have a few prizes and gifts to people that have long length of service, some of those kind of ideas and things. But then we have what is called dueling pianos. I don't know if you know, in Metropolitan here in town, they have those dueling pianos. Well, we happen to have a connection with them. And we will have the dueling pianos here. Very entertaining. We've done it before, haven't we, Doug? Yes, we went out one time, our wives and us went out, and it was a fun time. And so we're going to have them here, and I hope you'll show up. So if you are a volunteer, please show up. We'd love for you to sign up. That'll help us to know how many people are going to show up. You can go online, I think. Is there any way for them to sign up? No, nothing. Yes. Just show up. And so we'd love to have you there. We'd love to have you here. Tomorrow night, 6 o'clock. It'll be a fantastic time. If you would please stand. And we're going to continue to worship our King today.
You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. I don't know about you, church, but there's nowhere else I'd rather be than in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So join with us in his presence today. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living home. Your presence, Lord. I have tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come fly this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that could ever I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. And for in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. Who am I that the highest King would welcome? I was lost, but he brought me his love for me. His love for me, who the sun sets free. Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child. A slave to sin. tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Moments where we feel unlovable, when we feel like we just keep getting it wrong, when we feel like we don't measure up, may we remember whose we are. We are yours, and you say different. So God, help us believe, even in our unbelief. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, hello, and welcome to Cheyenne Hills. You know, there are things we always seem to say to our kids. Share with your sister. don't be mean to your brother. If you can't say something nice, but think back over the past week, were there maybe a few times you failed to do some of the things we teach our children? Which brings us to this series. The Bible's filled with tales galore of creation and redemption, and Paul tells us they're perfect for correction and instruction. But when we've heard them many times in many different places, we start to hear God's word with blank expressions on our faces, like stories from our childhood that sure taught us a lot, but now with grown-up worries, there's some we plumb forgot. About temptation, faithfulness, and shooting jealous glances, of sharing Jesus with our neighbors, and even second chances. So come with us and take a trip through stories from our youth. We'll adventure in some children's tales and find biblical truths. And with who better, naturally, than good old Dr. Seuss. Most of us know today's story of Green Eggs and Ham. Sam I Am does everything he can to get his friend to try something he knows he'll like. But his friend flatly refuses. Over and over, Sam tries everything he can, but his friend will not budge. Sam knows if he tried Green Eggs and Ham, he'd love it, so he keeps convincing him for the sake of his friend. And of course, once he tries it, he loves it and is grateful to Sam for never giving up. I wonder if we can guess what today's message is about.
Sam, I Am, and he did not give up. How many of you, did everybody know the story? Everybody kind of, okay, so you know, a lot of you know the story. And I don't know why, I've never seen a Dr. Seuss sales conference based on Sam, I Am, but this guy is relentless. He's got to take more no's than anybody I've ever seen, and he does not give up. He never loses a smile. He never loses his enthusiasm. I don't know why it's not the top of the charts on sales. But anyway, I don't know if you've ever been around somebody that just persistent like that again and again and again. And finally, you just, okay, fine. Okay, I'll give in. Some of you are trying to go through your minds. Let me give you a shortcut. If you have children, see, I knew some of you got there real quick. If you have children, you know what I'm talking about. They can be relentless on persistence. My daughter was our relentless one, and she was really good at it too, and it was like a debate with her. It was like a structured strategy, and she'd keep bringing different ideas and into light to try to make her case for why she should do a certain thing. Probably the most memorable one for me was when she was a freshman in high school, and she got invited to the prom by a boy that was a junior in high school. And of course, I pondered for 2 seconds and said no. I said, honey, no, you can't have. But Dad, you know, and she gave me all these kind of cool arguments, good ones, but this was the best one. Because she knows just a little bit about me, and she goes, okay, Dad, just think about this. You know how difficult it is to get to the Super Bowl? Yeah? You see where this is going? And she goes, so like, There's only a few Super Bowls that people, pro athletes, get a chance to be a part of. This is a freshman in high school. This is what I had to deal with. The prom is like a Super Bowl for me. I only got 4 shots at it. So, honey, that's a good argument. But no. You're not going to go to the prom with this boy that's a junior. And I don't know. I'm sure we read Green Eggs and Ham. I don't know if she was using Sam I Am as a metaphor or a picture for her, but she was relentless like this on the things that she would say. And I said something along the lines, I think, that you're not going to go on this date. You're just going to have to wait. You're not going to the prom, and don't even go ask your mom. I've checked the guy, so just don't bother. If you don't believe me, ask your brother. So, I doubt if I said that, but since I'm in the Seuss mode. But anyway, it went something like that. But if you've ever had somebody in your family or somebody in your life be persistent, you know what I'm talking about. Well, today I'm going to talk to you about being persistent with the things of God. I've been most amazed with this Seuss series. You know, I came up with an idea like, okay, we need to talk about and preach these concepts and here's some verses and everything. And then our creative team comes up with all these cool ideas of packaging. Well, this time they came up with this Dr. Seuss series, and I thought, I don't know. I mean, this is a little silly. It's a little, I don't know. I'm not sure. It's a little controversial. And so I wrestled with it, drug my heels. And here's what I've concluded. This stuff is so sticky that I have a feeling that when I'm gone, I mean, years past, they're going to say, I don't remember one sermon he ever preached, but do you remember that Seuss series? That's what I think is going to happen, because this is such sticky stuff. And I've been wondering about, why is this stuff so sticky? And I think I know the reason. It's a lot like Jesus telling parables. He told parables that were right where the people were living. And if you have children in last hunk of time, 20-some years, then you've probably either seen or heard or read these books. And they're sticky. They have the concepts that they're easy to grasp. You know, think about what Jesus did with the kingdom of God. He was trying to describe a place that is undescribable in human terms, but he said this: the kingdom of heaven is like a farmer that took some seed and threw it on the rocky places along the road, and the ravens came and ate it up right away. Some of that seed fell on rocky soil. It sprouted up, but it didn't have any root, and so it withered away. Some of it fell on ground that had thorns and thistles, but although it grew up quickly, the thorns and thistles grew up and strangled out that plant. And some of that farmer's seed fell on fertile ground, and it produced 50, 80, 100-fold of what was planted. Now, that's a sticky metaphor, sticky parable, because everybody, whether you were a farmer back 2,000 years ago, or if you are a gardener today, you know, okay, I understand plants and I understand soils and I understand what he's trying to communicate here. There's a condition of the heart. And sometimes our hearts are hard and sometimes they're rocky and sometimes there's thorns and thistles and the world chokes it out. And sometimes his word hits me and it produces 50, 60, 100-fold what was planted. I think that's why this Seuss series, it's familiar, it's simple, it's kind of raw and in your face, and yet somehow these concepts attach, biblical concepts can attach to this and go deep in our soul. And I'm actually thankful for that. Today we're going to talk about three things. We're going to talk about blessed feet. We're talking about going. Go, dog, go. That's a great one. It's a different book, but same Seuss kind of metaphor. And then taste and see. And that's really the theme of this Green Eggs and Ham, is taste and see. And we're going to talk about that. Blessed are the feet. There is nobody that has weirder feet than Seuss feet. I mean, Sam has some great feet, but they're weird. They're kind of pointy, kind of hairy. But his feet are blessed, and we're going to find out why they are blessed feet. We're going to start in Romans chapter 10, verse 15. And it goes like this: and how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. What's the good news? That's that Jesus Christ came and died on the cross to pay for our sins, for yours and mine. And for those who receive that good news will inherit eternal life. How beautiful are the feet that bring or preach that good news. And so, how do you know if you're sent? You know, some people say, well, I'm not sent because I'm not a missionary and I'm not a preacher. And by the way, if you don't have a Bible, please raise your hand, because I'm going to have some passages that you won't have. And so they'll bring you a Bible. And keep this as a gift from us to you as well. But there's some people that say, well, I'm not really sent because I'm not a preacher, I'm not a missionary. But I will tell you, I believe your feet are blessed if you go, if you're blessed if you bring this good news. You know, Sam is kind of a kook, if you will. He's kind of annoying. He's so happy that it almost makes you uncomfortable. And he's got beautiful feet. You know, we may not like the delivery system of Sam. He's maybe too over-optimistic. He's been told no 1,000 times. And he does not take no for an answer. I mean, he says, I would not eat them here or there. I would not eat them anywhere. I would not eat them in a box with a fox, on a house with a mouse. I would not eat them, Sam, I am. I mean, that's a no, wouldn't you say? That, I've taken that as a no, not Sam. How about a train? Would you eat them? Could you eat them on a train? He is relentless. Beautiful are the feet that bring good news. I think we are supposed to be a little bit relentless as well. I'm not one of those people that is necessarily motivated by rewards, crowns in heaven. However, you can't deny the fact that there are crowns in heaven. Crowns in heaven for doing things that matter to God. Having beautiful feet is one of those. I'm going to read just several of them. There's an incorruptible crown mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 25, for those who live a disciplined life. There's a crown of life, according to James chapter 1, verse 12, for those who patiently endure trials and testing. There's a crown of glory for those who faithfully care for his flock, 1 Peter 5, 2 through 4. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, there's a crown of righteousness for those who love his appearing. And finally, here's the one that I wanted to drive home. In 1 Thessalonians 2, there's a crown of rejoicing for all who are faithful soul winners. That's really what Seuss is talking about here. I doubt that he set out thinking, okay, I'm going to teach people how to be soul winners or how to be salesmen. I don't think either one was on his mind. But when we take this concept and baptize it in the context of what God would have us to do, it's a pretty good picture. A metaphor of beautiful feet that bring this good news. And I said this before, it's like personally rewards aren't a great motivator for me. However, I will say this, rewards do keep me from stopping. Rewards do keep me from quitting. When I get discouraged, when I hear a no, when I get rejected, when I think no one's listening. Rewards in heaven, it's like the faithfulness of those who bring this good news, there's going to be reward. And it keeps me, it doesn't really propel me forward, but it keeps me from stopping. I don't know if that makes sense. Galatians 6, 9 is a passage we've all heard. Let us not get tired of doing what is good. I don't know if anybody of you are trying to be those blessed feet for somebody in your family, somebody in your neighborhood, somebody in your work, and you're getting this, no, thank you, I'm not interested. Let us not give up, not be tired of doing what is good. At the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we do not give up. Boy, if there's anything that this book talks about, it's not giving up. Sam, I am, did not lose his smile. He did not lose his motivation. He did not lose his go. I thought I'd bring a quote from Skillet, since we have green eggs and ham. It's a Christian rock band called Skillet. Her name's Corey Cooper. This is what she said, and I like it. She said, I've tasted too much to walk away. You know, that's a little bit of our lives, isn't it? There's a lot of things we don't fully understand. You know, people bring up questions like, well, why this? Or why does the church do this? Why does God say this? What's God's stance on marriage? God's stance on this? And then I just can't accept those things. And so those are no's. We just say, okay, I'm going to stop pushing. But I will tell you, what Corey said is something, it's like, I've tasted too much of God's goodness to walk away. I know this is real. And it leaves us in this dilemma. So what are we supposed to do with this? According to Scripture, Jesus told his disciples to go. I'm labeling this section, Go, Dog, Go, because that's a cool book too of Seuss. We just didn't get to talk about it. Jesus came to his disciples. He said this, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We're going to do that today. You're going to see it on display. Teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. That's the whole counsel of God, Old Testament, New Testament, all that I've commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Here's an interesting thing about that word go. It means as you go, or it can mean wherever you go. Go. And as you go, make disciples. Go. And wherever you go, make disciples. I don't care if it's on a hunting trip, if it's on a fishing trip, if it's on vacation, if it's at work, if it's at school, you go. You go and you be faithful. That's what Jesus is asking his disciples to do. And wherever you go, and his disciples were scattered. Some stayed in Jerusalem. Some went up to Rome. One went to India. They scattered. They took the gospel and they went. This was the mission statement of the church. Last thing that Jesus said, one of the last things he said, and he said, go. And what he meant was, as you go, make disciples and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. I will be with you always to the end of the age. Boy, if there's somebody in this that models this, it would be Sam. The persistent pest on the go. Would you eat them in a boat? Would you eat them with a goat? Would you eat them here or there? I don't know if you've looked at these things. They're nasty looking deals. I mean, this is like a sunny side up green egg. I don't like sunny side up eggs at all. And green ones are not appealing to me. I mean, that almost gaggy like, right? Green ham, bad idea, you know? So I understand this guy's no, right? Man, did that stop Sam? Holy smokes, he just would not give up. Paul didn't have a stop button in him either. He went from Jerusalem to Damascus. It's a pretty long road, by the way, if you've ever looked at that, to Damascus to walk it. And he was going with a letter from the church synagogue in Jerusalem to bring out and bring back to Jerusalem or persecute those who are a part of the way. That's the church. They were part of this group called The Way. And he was going to chase them down all the way to Damascus and drag them out, expose them, and bring them to justice, maybe stoning like Stephen, maybe imprisonment, whatever it took to squash this message. Jesus met Paul on the road to Damascus. At that time, his name was Saul. Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Jesus says. He was blinded. He goes to town. Ananias was called by God to go pray over this guy, Paul, Saul. Ananias argued with God. God, are you sure this guy's he's a bad cat? He says, yeah, go. Pray for him. Scales fall off his eyes. Immediately, the Bible says, he started preaching the gospel. You talk about a change. And from that point on, this new guy, Paul, who used to be Saul, now he's Paul, did not have a stop button in him. You talk about a guy with go. He would go to one town and preach the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, and said, I was this guy. I was persecuting Christians, and yet I met this man on the road to Damascus. His name was Jesus Christ. Changed my life. And some of them accepted him. Some of them rejected him. Some of them beat him to a bloody pulp, left him for dead. Now, I don't know. It probably would take one beating for me, and I'm just like, okay. But for Paul and for Sam, not a deterrent. I just kept going to the next place. It's amazing. And to the next place, and to the next place. I don't know if you've lost your go or not. Here's what Paul said, and this was his message. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. He says, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. God is making his appeal through us. Now, I would argue that God could have a better plan than using us. It's like, God, is that your best idea? I mean, we're like fallible human beings. And the most important message of all the universe is that Christ has come and conquered sin and death so that you can have eternal life with him, so that when you die, you will go be with him. That's good news. All you have to do is just accept him. Just receive this gift. That's it. In his delivery system, you and me. That's risky. Because we're not perfect. We're a long way from it. And it's like, Lord, if I tell somebody, I'm not sure if they're going to listen to me. And he says, yeah, just go. I'll use you. I'll be with you. Just go. Tell your story. Tell your story of how messed up you were and what happened when you met Christ on the road to your Damascus. Tell that story. I'll use it. Go. And so what Paul is saying here in 2 Corinthians, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. God is making his appeal through us, through our story, through our brokenness, through our messed up lives. That's his delivery system. Here's what he says. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Implore doesn't do a lot for me. Maybe it doesn't do much for you. Some versions say this, we beg you on behalf of Christ. This is Paul's message. This is his intensity. He's saying, he's getting before anybody he could get in front of, and he says, we beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Christ came from heaven to earth, and he paid for the sin of mankind to reconcile us to the Heavenly Father. I beg you, he says, to listen to that message. And God uses you and me as his delivery system to go to your work, to your recreation, to your school, to your home, to your family, to your friends, to your neighbors, to your, go. Tell your story. Finally, taste and see. You know, I think it's one of the cool passages in Scripture. You know, as I said before, these on the surface, these Greek eggs and ham, they are not appealing at all. There's nothing about them that makes you think, wow, these look good. I don't know how hungry I would have to be personally to eat a sunny side up egg. And I eat a lot of eggs. But to eat a green sunny side up egg, I'd have to be pretty hungry. Taste and see. What a picture of just taste. Just try this. Just try it once. One bite, you'll be hooked. Just try it. Please. No, absolutely not. Not on a train, not with a goat, not on a boat, not in a box, not anywhere. Not here or there, not anywhere. How about in a tree? Would you try in a tree? Holy smokes, Sam. Taste and see. Psalm 34:8 says this, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. If you just taste it, just taste what I've tasted. Just you'll see this forgiveness that God has. You'll see a righteousness that God gives to man that you can't fathom how much God loves you. But I can't do it for you. I can't take the salvation and stick it in your pocket. You have to taste and see for yourself. I think one of the most gripping passages as far as a taste and see passage that honestly I think it's one of the more difficult passages certainly in the New Testament to understand, to digest, if you will. I'm going to start with in John chapter 6 about 35. Basically what happened is this. There's a whole bunch of people that came to see Jesus. He'd been healing people and they thought, wow, let's come out and go see. Let's go see what's going on here. So they had part of the thing right. And then Jesus says to his disciples, what should we do about feeding all these people? And they were served eating off of the, what I'm going to call the world plate. The world plate is all the things that man can think of. And just so you know, I'm not scolding any of you. I live off this world plate as well. And Jesus was testing his disciples to see if any of them were willing to take any of his food off of the kingdom plate. Okay? And the world plate, he said, well, you feed them. And they were looking around like, well, how are we going to do this? And the first thing they did is they said, well, I know what we can do. Let's just send them all home so they can eat at their own homes. Great idea. They were a long way from home, by the way. But that was the first world plate idea that came up. The second world plate idea that came up was they started calculating. Well, it's like, well, okay, how much if each person had this much bread? And I was like, how much? And they came up with this huge number. And they said, well, it would cost this huge number to feed everybody. So, but they did think of the, maybe we just throw enough money at it. That's a world plate thought. We do that a lot. Andrew was interesting. He kind of gave a world plate slash he was, I think he took a grape or two or trying to off of the kingdom plate when he said this. I found this kid that he's got some loaves and fishes. I don't know if anything maybe could happen there. See, the way that he says that, the fact that he even brings it up, makes me think he was trying to take something off the kingdom plate. He was trying to do a faith thing. So maybe we can give him some credit for at least trying to bridge that gap. Jesus wanted them to see the kingdom plate. And he says, all right, put everybody in groups of whatever they were. He divided them up in groups. And he took the loaves and the fishes and he blessed them. And I don't know exactly how it happened, but it happened and bread and fish were fed to 5,000 men. There was probably women and children. So how many people altogether? I do not know. You take a guess. 5,000 is a big number with a few loaves and fishes. Now you can imagine what this did with people. It's like, wow, this guy's even better than Moses. Moses brought down manna from heaven every day. This guy brings out bread and fish. This guy could be good. And so Jesus then it goes across the lake, and this is when, or the Sea of Galilee, and then he comes walking on the water, and that's when all that scene happened, and then they get to the other side. Well, the next morning, all these people knew that Jesus had gone around, and they went around the north part of that Sea of Galilee to the other side of the river, if you will, the inlet, and they found Jesus. And they were wanting him for, I think, all the wrong reasons. They were wanting him, it's like, this is a guy that's got some power. This is a guy that could fix some of our world problems. This is a guy that could fill our bellies, possibly pad our wallets. Let's get this guy at our table, right? World plate ideas, man thinking ideas. Jesus recognizing this world plate thinking, and he's trying to introduce this man plate, or I'm sorry, kingdom plate thinking. So I want you to keep that in mind as I start to read here. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you may have seen me, and yet you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up in the last day. So he's talking about kingdom plate stuff, eternal life stuff. Verse 40, for this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life. I will raise him up in the last day. This is kingdom plate, eternal life, salvation stuff. That's what he's serving. What they're still looking for is the world plate stuff. Fill our bellies, fill our wallets. Watch this. Verse 41, then the Jews grumbled about him because he said, I am the bread of life that came down from heaven. And they said, is this not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he say, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up in the last days. It is written in the prophets, and they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. He has seen the Father, meaning himself. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and they died. This bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. He's speaking of himself now. This is getting kind of weird. He's trying to get him to think kingdom plate stuff. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I give for life of the world is my flesh. Okay, this is like, okay, if you're standing there, you're listening to this, you're going, what the heck? Am I supposed to take a bite out of his arm? What is he asking me to do here? The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, truly I say to you, that unless you eat the flesh. Now, this is where he just goes, this is so unappealing. he goes to a level, and it's like you almost kind of go, ah, Lord, that's enough. Ah. No one's going to believe in you. But this may be the point. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up in the last day. For my flesh is true food, my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As a living Father sent me, I live because the Father, whoever feeds on me will live because of me. And it's like, oh my gosh, the metaphors here are just overwhelming. Now, we look at this, look back on this, and we know what he's talking about. Breaking the bread, drinking the cup, symbolic of his body broken, his blood shed. I get it. But in the real time there, those guys were trying to grapple with this. This is why people in the first century thought that these people of the way were cannibals, because they kept talking about eating the flesh and drinking his blood. It wasn't literally his flesh and literally his blood. It was symbolic. And when we receive Christ in our life, his whole being doesn't fit inside of us, but we receive his substitutionary death on the cross. That's what he's talking about. But these people, I think, were coming to him and saying, we want our bellies full like what Moses did. And the fish would be a nice little perk too. And maybe the fish could actually pad our pockets, because those things, that's some worse something. We could sell those fish. You see, I think Jesus saw something in their motivation. They just basically were wanting him to slide up a chair at the table and kind of be a part of their committee, their worldview. And it's like, it'd be really nice to have you here, because anytime we need something for our bellies or something for our wallets, you'll be pretty handy. Listen, Jesus isn't a guy just to sit at your table. He's not just the guy to be kind of handy. He's not the lucky rabbit's foot kind of God that you maybe have heard about. I was being a pest, if you want to call it that, to a guy one time. And he came up and nudged me. He's kind of a guy that could nudge me and knock me over. He kind of came up to nudge me, and he said, you know, I just want you to know that I've invited Christ to sit at my table. Jesus is sitting at my table now. And I thought, man, that's good. That's really good. And I probably said, that's good. As I thought about it, I thought, okay, actually, that's a good start. Because if Jesus is just scooting up next to you in your table, do you realize that he's the creator of all the universe, and you're saying that he's got a seat at your table? I mean, that's a good start, but he's the God of the universe. He is the Lord of the forest. He created the tree that made the table that you're sitting at. He's the Lord of the minerals that made the quartz that goes into that china plate that you're eating off of. He's the Lord of the hills that created the grass, that feeds the sheep, that made the wool, that puts the placemats and the napkins on your table and your place settings. He's the Lord of the mines that made the nickel and the steel to coat the silverware that you're eating with. And he's got a place at your table. That's good. The challenge, though, is this. There's a lot of people, I think, that have Jesus as the seat of the table. Make sure he's the Lord of your life. Make sure he's the Lord of your table. He's the Lord of your heart. He's the Lord of your family. That's what he wants you to see. And I think that's what he wanted these people to see. He's not there just to fill the bellies. He can do that. Or pad the wallet. He can do that. He wants to know first, is he the Lord of your life? We're going to have some people that are going to be baptized today. And I think it's a picture of making Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. They've done that in their hearts. But this is a powerful picture of that, I think. And I'm just going to challenge you today. If you have never, if that's you, and you said, you know what, I've kind of told Jesus he could have a place at the table. I'm not sure I've made him Lord of my life. I'm going to ask you to pray with me. I'd like to challenge you to make him Lord. He is Lord. But he's not going to take that place unless you say, okay, in my house, he's Lord. He's Lord over this table. He's Lord over this china, over these silverware, over this place settings. He's a creator. He's the Lord. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, if there's someone in this room that said, you know what, I think I'm that guy or I'm that gal. Know Jesus, love Jesus, won't even be a part of my life, but I'm not sure if my motives are right. And today, Lord, there might be someone that says, I just want him to be Lord, period. Whether what he provides, what he doesn't provide, that's totally up to him. I'm going to take whatever he gives me or whatever he takes away. I'm just going to make him Lord. And it goes, a prayer goes, it's real simple. It goes like this: Lord, I confess I've sinned and I am sorry. I've had wrong motives. I've served off the world plate, and I very rarely think about the kingdom plate, and I'm sorry. Lord, I believe that your blood shed and your body broken is my salvation. And I bring that into my life. I receive that into my life. I want you to be my Lord and my Savior, my forgiver and my friend. Lord, I want you Lord of my table. I want you Lord of my life. Lord, anybody that's prayed that prayer today, I pray that they sense that they've done something that's really powerful. It's a shift in our thinking that I think we are just a little shallow sometimes in our understanding of you and who you are. God, thank you. Thank you for receiving us. Thank you for using us. We are ambassadors. It's amazing that you use us. Help us, God, to continue to go. I pray this thing in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we've got several that are going to be baptized today, and you are going to see something. It's going to be a treat. These guys are going to sing, I think, one of the cool baptism songs that I've ever heard. And if this happened to grab your heart today and you said, you know what, I wish I'd have thought about being baptized, then I'd say, stop thinking and just show up. You will dry off. Come to the front of this room and we will walk you through these waters. It's a powerful time. Hope you can join us. And this is Kaylee, is that right, Kaylee? I think you told me how old you were.
12.
You're 12 years old. Sixth grade, something like that. So Kaylee, what does this mean to you? You got grandma here, you got mom, dad, grandpa. Does anybody want to say something about this little girl? I'm pretty proud
she's
of her.
She's precious, and she's known the Lord from before she was born. through right. Our mom's prayers and the Amen. Christian music.
That's
the
cool.
The Christian stories after she was born.
That's awesome. That's
Lots
awesome.
Of prayers.
Really proud of you, Kaylee. You're very, very well surrounded here. Before your family, before your Heavenly Father, before your church family, do you profess Jesus as your Savior?
Yes.
It's on your profession of faith in Him that we baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, girl. That's awesome. Congratulations, man. That's awesome. 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 Good job. Thank you, Rhonda. It's awesome. Nice. That family's been here a long time, since the beginning of Cheyenne Hills Church, right? Three generations baptized here. That is awesome, Dave. That is awesome. Gosh, give him a hand. That's awesome. Anna. This is quite a family here, too. What does this mean to you today, Anna?
I just want to confess Jesus as my Savior and have him.
Well, that's what you're doing. You're making your statement loud and clear. When you stand before God, it says, Jesus said, if you profess me before men, I will profess you before my Father in heaven. And that's exactly what you're doing today, Anna. I'm so proud of you. Before God, before your family, your church family, do you profess Jesus as your Savior? It's on your profession of faith in him that we baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk in a new way of life. God bless you, sweetheart. Awesome. Awesome. Yeah, you better take those. You can take your socks off, too. They might, I don't know, you can do whatever you want. Nico? Sophomore in high school. That's, I'm really proud of you. What does this mean to you today?
This means that I'm committing my whole life to Jesus, yep. And he's going to walk with me for the rest of my life.
That's awesome. And you made your faith commitment early on, but I think making your statement here today is, just, I can tell you, you got a very proud mama, and you got a very proud papa. Your Heavenly Father is also proud of you. Before your church family, before your Heavenly Father and your parents, you profess Jesus as your Savior. It's on your profession of faith in him that we baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, man. Good job. Good job. That's awesome. Sweet family. Oh, we're not done. I forgot. Awesome. This is little brother. Colton. Oh my gosh. That's all right. Oh, Colton, you're awesome, dude. Colton, how old are you?
I'm 8.
Dude, I'm so proud of you. What's this mean to you?
It means that I'm showing everybody that I love God.
Would you give this guy a hand? You just had about 400 people fall in love with you right now. You realize that? Colton, before your church family, before mom and dad, your brother and sister, this is a big day for you guys. Do you profess Jesus as your Savior?
Yes.
Yes. It's on your profession of faith in him that I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk in a way of life. God bless you, brother. That's awesome. Oh, my gosh. That's so awesome. So proud of you guys. That's awesome. What a day. Wow. Wow. That's awesome. This is Sarah. Sarah's good journey here. Sarah, what's this mean to you today?
A lot of different things.
Yeah.
That I am enough. I guess he's enough.
That's good. That's really good. Good word. And you are enough. This is Christ in you. You might want to sit down because it might be better for knees. You can do whatever you want. Sarah, before your church family, before your Heavenly Father, do you profess Jesus as your Savior?
I do.
It's on your profession of faith in him that we baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, Sarah. God bless you. Awesome. That is so awesome. Really proud of you. Madeline, there you go. I told you it was warm. You didn't even believe me, did you?
No.
You thought I was kidding. Look, the duck says. What's the duck say? It's like 100 degrees in there. 95. What's this mean to you, Madeline?
Well, this means that I believe in God and that I feel that.
That's enough. That is enough. That's for you. Say absolutely.
As soon as it's in front of an audience, I forget everything.
Yeah,
I'm
I understand.
Say.
That's right.
I'm the grandma who prays constantly for my kids and grandkids.
Nice.
And today, two of them are getting baptized.
Oh, that's sweet. Give her a hand. Way to go, Grandma. Awesome, Madeline. Before your family, before your church family, before your Heavenly Father, do you profess Jesus as your Savior?
I do.
It's on your profession of faith in Him that we baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, Spirit. Awesome. Awesome. Make sure to help her out here. It's kind of slick. Congratulations. Oh, we got one more. Is this our birthday boy?
Yes.
This is a 12 today. Like today. Would you give him a 12-year-old happy birthday? That's awesome, Hunter. This is a cool kid. I don't know him really, but when he started talking, it's like, I think you know everybody pretty easily, don't you?
Yes.
Yeah. What's this mean to you today, Hunter?
Well, I want to show everybody that I'm ready to live my life for Jesus.
Amen. Man, I'm proud of you. 12 years old today. Happy birthday. Hunter, before your Heavenly Father, before your church family, do you profess Jesus as your Savior? It's a profession of faith in Him. We baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, brother. Awesome, Hunter. Good job, man. That's awesome. Oh, bless you. Yeah, are you kidding? That's awesome. Congratulations. Lillian. Does anybody want to say something about this young lady? She's a sweet, huh? Do you have something, Mom, you want to say about her?
Yes. Lily has an amazing heart.
Yes, she does.
So I'm super proud of her today because she wanted to come forward and do this.
Yeah. Makes moms really happy when they see their kids make professions of faith. Lily, before your Heavenly Father, before Mom, family, do you profess Jesus as your Savior?
Yes, I do.
It's on your profession of faith in Him. We baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, sweetie. Awesome. Really proud of you. God help you. Awesome. Good job, Mom. Jacoby, is that right? Is that how you say your name? 8 years old, is that right? Dude, did you ever stop smiling? You were smiling the whole time I was talking to you. You got a good smile. What's this mean to you, Jacoby?
Being with God.
Sorry?
Being with God.
Being with God, yes. You've asked, your mom told me you've asked Jesus into your heart, and this is you're making your stand before Him today, and I'm really proud of you. Mom, do you have anything you want to say about this guy?
I'm just really proud of him. He made this decision on his own, and we actually turned around, and I was like, we have to have family here in pictures, but you know, he made the Holy Spirit.
Oh, you were here speaking. The first service and you came back.
Yeah, we turned around because he was in the car, and gotcha. So you know, the Holy Spirit is speaking to him, and this is his decision with God.
Jacoby, really proud of you, brother. Jacoby, before your mom, your Heavenly Father, your church family, do you profess Jesus as your Savior?
Yes.
It's on your profession of faith in Him. We baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, brother. It's awesome. Awesome. Good job. Good job. That is cool. Good story. Yeah, come everybody who's from Bristol, come up here. Someone want to say anything about this young lady?
We're just really proud of the decision that she's made to do this.
Yep, I am too. Bristol, how old are you?
Nine.
9 years old. I'm really proud of you today. Are you nervous? You're standing before God today, and He is so proud of you, just like your family is so proud of you. Bristol, before your Heavenly Father and your family, do you profess Jesus as your Savior? It's on your profession of faith in Him that we baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ, raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you. Congratulations. God bless you, guys. Okay. Awesome, Daniel. Man, so were you just standing, sitting back there, and just God just kind of what? Did He tug on your heart? How did this work?
I was thinking of everyone getting baptized, yeah. And I've always wanted to be baptized.
That's
so
awesome. You picked a good day. How old are you?
I am 11.
11 years old. Do you have anything you want to say about this young man?
Just very proud of him. Yeah. We didn't know the baptism was going to be today. We were actually talking about baptism this week. So.
Okay. It was your day. Daniel, I'm really proud of you. Before your Heavenly Father, your family, do you profess Jesus as your Savior?
Yes.
It's on your profession of faith in Him that we baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You're buried with Christ. You're raised to walk a new way of life. God bless you, Daniel. Proud of you, brother. Awesome. It's awesome. Good job. Awesome. Very nice. All right, everybody stand. I'm going to ask these guys to sing one verse, and I'm going to give you one verse. If God's tugging on your heart and you've been thinking, you know what, I need to do this. Don't miss this moment. We'll wait. Go ahead and sing. Go ahead.
I
need you. Oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
We will wait. They're going to sing one more verse. We're going to wait for you guys. Move this way so you can have a huge cloud of witnesses. There might be one more person that wants to get baptized today.
Oh, forgiveness. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like a sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
Feels good, doesn't it? I am so proud of all you guys. This is awesome. This is quite a crew. Renee, would you pray for us all?
Father, we just rejoice with all the families, with all the people here today, of what you're doing in these lives. And Father, thank you for their courage to come forward to publicly proclaim their love for your son, Jesus. Thank you so much, God, for how you're working in our hearts. Thank you, God, for just each person up here. And Father, I just pray over them today that you would nurture their faith, that you would protect their faith, that you would grow their faith, that Father, you would use their faith to bring their friends and family to you, that they would be like Sam I Am. And Father, thank you so much, and may you get the glory from what happened here today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. I'm so proud of you guys. Wow. Here, a smile for the camera right here. As you go across the street and around the world, I hope that you will go and take Jesus Christ with you. God bless you all.
Proud of you.
Sweet, sweet honey on my
Well, we are back in studio with Pastor Galen. What an amazing weekend. I always love baptism weekend. Too. It's one of my favorites. And I, you know, I always get emotional just seeing people. It's a big deal to make that commitment.
It is
so
a big deal.
So it was a great, great weekend. And you know, how cool was it that you were able to tie this green eggs and ham? And when was it that he decided to try them?
Well, he was in the water.
Yeah.
You know, it's like this was a baptism weekend. And honestly, that was not planned. It's one of those things you kind of discover. It's like, wow, we just landed. And and I did not realize that he finally tried the green eggs and ham, you know, in the sea or in the ocean, or he was in water. And I just think it's an amazing kind of a connection. But it is amazing to me. Baptism is that outward sign of an inward reality. And it is amazing how powerful it is for people. I remember even when I was baptized, you know, I grew up in a church that didn't baptize by immersion. Mm-hmm. So when I went to seminary, we got involved with the church that baptized by immersion. And I just thought, okay, I'm going to check the box. And Mary Kay and I were baptized together. And I can tell you, it was way more than checking the box. It was, and I don't believe it's salvific, but I do believe it is more powerful than I probably ever expected. And I see that, you know, in the eyes of people when they come forward and they're making their statement before God and before their church family, before their family, and in some cases even their small group. You know, it sticks.
You know, Corey and I had a similar experience, and we were baptized as adults as well. And it was when we started attending Cheyenne Hills.
Okay.
And one of the things that was really difficult for me was because we had been baptized as infants, that
sure.
did that take away what my parents had done
right.
for me? And,
right. It's a big
and it
struggle.
Doesn't. And so I think that's, you know, it's just one of those things that we have to work through, and it doesn't deny that experience or lessen that, or even if you've been, because I, you know, we went through everything. I was baptized, I was confirmed, and then baptized as an adult. But then to really make that decision for myself was a really big thing. And so I always admire people that are ready to just to jump in and be all in.
Well, and then you and Corey were baptized together. That is a connection. That's a spiritual connection. That's, I think, very powerful.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, so going back to the Green Eggs and Ham book, one of the things that stood out to me also is that Sam was persistent in asking.
Yeah.
And how often in evangelism are we, I've asked once and now and they said no.
Yeah.
And so I've got to pull back because I don't want to offend. And, you know, and green eggs and ham isn't really that appealing as a part of how it looks.
That's true.
But, you know, life in Christ, oh my goodness, that can be just amazing. And so how much we have to offer when we are sharing the gospel to someone, and that we can really be offering something so much better.
For sure. And this is sticky stuff.
Yeah.
And it's amazing to me. It's like this metaphor. I'm sure Seuss never thought evangelism when he was writing Green Eggs and Ham. But the stickiness of the metaphor and the application of it, boy, it really works. And I like the fact that they ended up right in the water when he tried it.
Yeah, it was amazing. So next week we're wrapping up our Truce and Seuss series with The Grinch.
The Grinch, that's
yes.
right. He's peeking around somewhere even in the shadows behind us now. And so the Grinch is coming up on Christmas. And so we're going to have to see how he likes to destroy and take away the joy of Christmas.
Mm-hmm. And what Christmas is really all about. So it's going to be great. And next Saturday is also our last Saturday night service.
Yep.
We're going to have just a special time with our Saturday night people. So if you want to be a part of that, that'll be really sweet.
Yep.
And looking forward to all of those things. So, but thanks so much for being in studio
great
and
weekend.
Unpacking all this. Has been a fantastic weekend.
Yep.
We look forward to connecting with you on social media. You can always follow us on Facebook, on Instagram, and Twitter. Please check out our YouTube channel. Subscribe to that as well. All of our podcasts are on there. Our services are on there. If you'd like to go back and check past services or just see different things that are going on here, you can certainly do that there as well. So in the meantime, enjoy what's this last week of October already? I
That's
can't believe it.
Yeah.
So flying by for sure. So anyway, have a wonderful week, and we will see you again.
God bless
next
you
week.
All.
Take care.